morning. On your seats in front of you, you'll have a worksheet that's got a red cover on it. And in that worksheet, you'll find all the insights that I'm going to share with regards to how purpose drives innovation. And we did that because we don't want you to spend your time capturing those insights, but rather for you to listen and apply those insights to your company so that you walk out with the most value in the room. Does that make sense? And in addition, what we're going to do is we're going to share all the slides at the end, both so that you can have all those assets, but you can also go back to your company and work with your teams and think through those questions collectively. Does that sound good? Okay, great. So let's dive in. The reason each of us wake up each Monday morning and plunge headlong towards a glass of Villa Maria on Friday afternoon is because each of us are reeling from the fact that we are now trying to engage a litany of media-savvy, intuitive, always-on connected consumers in a way that we've never had to face before as marketers. And really, here's what's happening. The reason purpose is driving innovation so effectively, there's three key areas. One is culture has changed. And by that I mean, thanks to the web, social media, and smartphones, that conspiracy of circumstances has created a situation where everyone we talk to is intimately aware of the compounding social crises we face, whether it's climate change, loss of biodiversity, ocean acidification, and they're looking to brands to be accountable. And that's compounded by the fact that you've got the UN Sustainable Development Goals, you've got the Paris Climate Agreement, you've got all the messaging that comes out of the World Economic Forum. That's one piece of it. The second piece is technology has changed. And who here's got kids? Who's got kids? Right? I've got a 17 and a 14-year-old. I don't even know what the color of their eyes are anymore because they're like this all the time. I love you, Dad. Right, sir. It's astonishing how connected they are. And if we think mobile, social, and the web really change marketing, when you layer on AR and AI and VR, it's going to be infinitely more complex, and we're going to be struggling to keep up. So that's the second change. The third change is this younger demographic, as Jeremy was talking about. I got to tell you, personally, since when does being born at a certain age serve as a qualification? Millennials, right? We should get responsibility for that. We're the ones who made them. Do we have any millennials in the room here? No millennials. Oh, one at the front. There's always one or two, right? Arrgh, millennials. But, you know, this is spoken about as a qualification. Oh my God, a living, breathing millennial. What's that like? But there you are at the intersection of these three trends. Any one of them is transformative in terms of our role as CEOs, CMOs, marketers. Together, it's a seismic shift, unlike we've ever seen before. And so here's the net result of it. This on your left is a rock concert. Do you remember a rock concert? You used to go there and you'd want to listen to the music and drink too much and hook up with a stranger and go home with music ringing in your ear. This is a rock concert today where everyone seems to go just to video and record it and take photographs and go home and look at how many people like their content. On one level, that is the end of the world as we know it. But on another level, it's also a huge opportunity because every single stakeholder in your brand community can become an extension of your marketing department if they're sufficiently motivated. And that's why purpose is so important. And in our vernacular, in our language, that necessitates a shift from being a me-first company, a self-directed company talking exclusively about your brand and your products, to being a we-first inclusive company, which really looks to be future-facing and looks at all stakeholders, not just shareholders. All those things that you hear talked about in marketing so much these days, authenticity, transparency, and so on. So I'm going to look at five different areas, kind of telescopically, so you can see a little bit of pattern recognition with regards to best practices by many of the leading purposeful brands out there and how they're driving innovation. And so the first thing I want to do is really identify what purpose means. Purpose is why you exist. It's why you exist. I think we all intuitively understand that. But it's also your objective, your intention. It's both a noun and a verb. And in our experience working with many of the world's leading brands, a lot of companies sort of immortalize it on their wall, in their mission statement, or whatever it might be, but it's not a daily practice. It's not a verb. And the most powerful thing you can do for your organization is to not only identify your purpose, but to bring it to life as a daily practice. And so, why would we do this? Every single one of us looks at a lot of research to justify, to substantiate the business case for what we do. And some of this may be familiar, some of it may not. But here we have Edelman's Trust Barometer report. 80% of global consumers believe that companies can have a social impact and drive profit. 80% of global consumers. But here's the missing piece of the puzzle. Globe Scan found that 67% of global consumers actually want to work with you to develop new products and services. So it's not about you taking the onus all upon yourself and developing your company, your products, and your services in a vacuum. They actually want to work with you. They want to be mobilized with you. In fact, 72% of them want to advocate with you for issues they care about. They're sitting there ripe with opportunity and intent to work with you, to realize the purpose, your articulated purpose. Yet too often we sit there just going, well, we're the ones, you know, the onus is on us exclusively, and we're just going to put out more effective products and services and maybe make a contribution in some way, but we're not actually going to mobilize them. We're not going to engage them. And then if you think about it in concentric circles, if you go from your inner stakeholders out to those who want to advocate with you, then you've got consumers, 71% of global consumers, who are actually willing to pay a premium for products or services that actually have a positive social and environmental impact. So what we constantly see is that companies are sort of under-indexing on putting their stakeholder communities to work. And if you've got limited resources or limited bandwidth or you're running lean, there is nothing more powerful than putting your entire community to work. So I really want to look at how you do that. And all of these statistics came out before what we've seen in the last few months, where there is an heightened degree of consumer activism. Just one example, delete Uber. You know, I'm based in Los Angeles, and throughout the states, people were deleting their Uber account because of, you know, statements by the CEO or things that have come to life in the press. And you're seeing a level of consumer activism unimaginable before all over the world, for example, the Women's March and so on. You know, just think about it historically. You've got millennials, you've got, you know, generations coming after them, all of whom have grown up with Arab Spring, Occupy Wall Street, all this consumer pushback, and now all of these movements around the world, and they're armed with intuitive technology in their hand. They don't know anything else. They don't think, should a brand be purposeful? They're like, how can you not be purposeful? And why are you not working with me to realize the vision of the world that we both share? That's what we're seeing in the most effective purposeful brands. And often we see a lot of research to this effect. We see data. But really, how does it build the bottom line? Give us the ROI. You know, you're responsible when you go into your own senior leadership teams to say, we need to do this. You've got to make the business case. Well, Harvard Business Review did a study, the business case for purpose. They did a study of 485 companies. And they found that those that prioritized purpose grew by 10% or more, as opposed to those that didn't. So there's now getting this sort of data, these metrics by which you can support it. And in fact, Imperative did a study in the US, and they found purpose-orientated workers are more likely to stay longer and 50% more likely to assume leadership positions. And we all know that talent acquisition, winning the talent wars, is absolutely a fundamental bottom-line driver. And if you looked at the sort of aggregate of their report, they found purpose-driven employees were 47% more likely to be net promoters of the brand, 64% got a higher level of meaning from their work, leadership potential, and then higher retention. So it's taken these last 5 years to really get that granular data to substantiate the business case, above and beyond the research, but it's there now. So it's not a question of if you should do it, but rather when and how fast. And this begs the question, how do you define your purpose, right? It's hard to define your purpose. In fact, the reason is it's hard to read the label from inside the jar. Have you ever found that? You're so consumed in the bubble of your workplace every day, it's almost like your brain is like you've got a speedball in there, and there's 4,000 versions of your purpose and different articulations of it and different language, and you can't get that clarity. It's because it's hard to read the label from inside the jar. Secondly, you're getting mixed messages. Increasingly, because we're so senior and wise in our age, there's some conflict between a sort of head-led past and a heart-led future. We're getting conflicting messaging. All right, we've got to meet our quarterly projections. We've got an analyst call coming up at the same time as our employees and our culture and all the brands we aspire to are doing all this wonderful heart-led stuff. So it's hard for us to rationalize that. And really, here's three suggestions as to how you can go about it. You heard Jeremy say, what his enemy was. All the BS around synthetic products, right? That was his enemy. For me, the company We First, my enemy was the me first mentality that led to the global economic meltdown in 2007, 2008. It's why I started the company. What's your enemy? If you can't define what your purpose is, define what you're against. With Tesla, unsustainable mass transportation. Elon Musk, when he wrote his first blog post, did not say he's starting a car company. He said he is enabling sustainable mass transportation, and by extension, battery technology, and just in case, a backup planet if we need it. Airbnb, their enemy is the homogenous, decultured experience of hotels. Uber, it's the taxi experience. So define your enemy. The second question, which is so, so powerful, is what makes you, you? What makes you, you? And I share these two fellows, Blake, who's the CEO of Tom's, and Sir Richard Branson, only because they're often pointed to as, or lauded as, the exemplars of what it means to be both entrepreneurial at scale. And it was really interesting. A couple of years ago, I was the interim CMO at Tom's, and we were sitting at a brand council meeting, and we were trying to think through the purpose of Tom's, because we were working with Bain Capital and Boston Consulting Group, and we were trying to think through what is their purpose. And there was a lot of really valuable things being shared in the room. But I said, stop. I said, stop, stop. And I looked at Blake and I said, hello, Blake. I said, why did you start the company? Why? And he stopped for a second, because it seemed like a logical question. And he said, I didn't want to start a company. I just wanted to put some shoes on that kid's feet. And in that moment, I realized his enemy was not bare feet. His enemy was apathy, the belief that there's nothing we can do about it. And the strength, the asset, the defining quality of the brand was, personally for him and by extension the company, his empathy. Why? Because it actually manifested in the form of a business model that was unprecedented, that he actually took to scale. So his enemy was apathy. And we've done training with Sir Richard and the Virgin folks for a while now, and you know, we were working together, and you know, we all sit there and go, I was personally sitting there going, what is it about this guy? What is it about him that makes him so, I mean, he's got over 300 companies, the Virgin Group, Virgin Unite, does so much impact work around the world. And someone asked him a question, someone in the room, we're at Necker Island, and someone in the room said, you're so successful. You have all these companies, you've made such a difference in the world. What does success mean to you now? What does success look like? It's a fair question, right? And he said, it was really interesting. He said, I've been fighting for my family for 40 years. That was his answer. And he went on from there. But the point was, what makes Virgin so unique as an extension of Richard is that he is all about family. And the relatedness that you have when you go to the airport and you're checking on a Virgin flight and their uniforms are a bit cooler and the purple lighting makes you feel like you're in a disco and they're playing cooler music, is actually that intimacy that's usually reserved for family is extended to everybody and to his employees. And his defining quality is how he treats everyone like family. So, what makes you you? It's hard for you to see an ex-girlfriend, ex-boyfriend, ex-lover could tell you in a heartbeat. But what makes you you? And then finally, what are you the only of? Whether you're Beth Comstock, who's now in charge of GE, or whether it's Sheryl Sandberg, one of the leadership team at Facebook. What are you the only of? And the reason we ask these three questions is because it's hard to read the label from inside the jar. You need to externalize yourself. You need to put yourself outside yourself and do pattern recognition thematically in terms of your answers to these questions. Because only then can you see, can you sort of rationalize it and look at it and go, oh my gosh, there's certain themes that emerge that keep coming up. So defining your purpose, if you want to leverage all these business drivers that are defining marketing as we look forward, you need to define what your purpose is in the first place. And to do that, you need to get off yourself, outside yourself, and answer these questions. So I would encourage you to do that with your leadership team. And what does that look like for some companies? Well, for Dove, to make beauty a source of confidence, not anxiety, creating possibilities for riders, drivers, and cities for Uber, and then Nike offering inspiration. Simple statements, but very, very specific. Very specific. And you know what's so interesting? All your success in terms of empowering your entire stakeholder community to amplify your brand, to advocate before your brand, to build your market share and your community is a function of how clear you are with them in terms of your messaging. Every single one of us have these supercomputers in our pocket irradiating at our Rogers zones right now, cooking them. That said, they are also incredibly powerful media distribution tools if people are sufficiently inspired. So you've got to give them that precise language because they're not marketers. They've got no idea. If you don't equip them with what to say, they're not going to be able to advocate on your behalf. So you need to be very, very clear. And so what does this look like in practice? So a real-world example. So working with Toms, the BCG research and had borne out that a lot of people understood the one-for-one model, right? You buy a pair of shoes, another pair of shoes is given. But really, what was that inspiration, that higher-order inspiration that informed Blake and, by extension, everyone who joined the company and company's impact on business and culture at large? And the solution we gave them was for one another, for one comma another. And why am I sharing this? It's because it's a demonstration of the compressed complexity that needs to inform your purpose. What do I mean? For one another, on the face of it, seems like a simple proposition. It's almost like the golden rule, do unto others and so on. But it allows leadership to speak to relate to employees for one another. The employees in the US to employees around the world to relate for one another. It allows you as a private sector to relate to the nonprofit sector for one another. It allows you to own a way of being in the world that is so powerful given the landscape, the global cultural landscape that we're in right now. So when you define your purpose, on the face of it, it's simple, but really, in truth, it has to have that compressed complexity and be so self-evident and so simple and allow you to speak to all the different stakeholders in specific ways, but still ladder up to the same singular message. Does that make sense? So that's why when you see Unilever with sustainable living or Starbucks with Shared Planet or Airbnb with Belong Anywhere, that's what they're doing. They're distilling their purpose, their messaging down to two or three simple words that are accessible and innately shareable that allows them to speak to all the different stakeholders in specific ways. And so much so that Blake got it tattooed on his left bicep. So the first question is, when you define your purpose, is what is it? The second is, what body part are you going to put it on? Feel free to volunteer it to the person next to you, make recommendations. We're all going to get very close over the next couple of days. And you know, one of the symptoms or one of the results of this is that you're now seeing more and more companies coming out with names that are fundamentally values propositions. Kind Bars, Honest Company, Innocent Smoothies, and so on. And even you're seeing this, the competitive landscape in the States is getting quite aggressive. So Fortune magazine has its Change the World list, where they now rank companies in terms of their purpose. So this is here. It's not going anywhere. This is the new normal for the reasons I talked about before. And I believe the most iconic brands of the future will be those with the greatest social impact. For all the self-evident reasons we know, the challenges we face as a species, as a planet, and beyond. So the key takeaway here is strategic purpose drives sustainable profit. It's not a nice to do, it's not an aspiration, it is a must do. And those who do it more effectively will win the war for consumer attention, advocacy, and ultimately growth. So, we're going to look at a few different areas that play this out. Firstly, your leadership. Every one of you in this room is in some leadership capacity. And what we've really noticed in terms of innovation and purpose-driving innovation is how the onus is now falling on you. You can't hide behind the boardroom door anymore. You can't hide behind your title, CEO or CMO. You can't hide behind your PR and reputation of the brand. In fact, everything your company does is an expression of you, because you're the prism through which all the innovation, energy, creativity, and resources of the company are being shone. In terms of your personal values, in terms of the company culture and how you treat your colleagues, in terms of the community with your customers and the society at large, and then culture, your impact on the world. So you can't hide anymore. You can't. When you think, it's not just the Howard Schultzes and the Paul Polmans of the world striding the public stage, it's every single brand is being thrust into the spotlight, and even more so its leadership. So we see this systemically around the world, different leaders coming to the fore, and they're doing different things. There's CEOs driving change, so Richard Branson here with climate change and the carbon war room at the World Economic Forum. Or we see Howard Schultz getting up at a stockholder meeting and saying, if you don't believe in the right to marry who you love, sell your stock. Very counterintuitive, not something you'd expect several years ago. Or if you see CEO of Apple, Tim Cook, getting up there and saying, literally taking on legislators saying, we do not agree with your LGBT legislation. CEOs, leadership, advocating in ways that just simply were unimaginable 5 or 10 years ago. And really what it is, it's a function of a new sort of brand of leadership out there, where vulnerability is strength. So you see here with Howard Schultz, you've got to share your soul and show them who you are and not be afraid of it. Or Paul Polman, my biggest fear is that I become useless. My fear is the fear of being obsolete. Those are not typical CEO statements. This is that new balance between confidence and vulnerability that is defining qualities of leadership. And so the key takeaway here is your company will grow in direct proportion to the personal work that every single one of you in this room do. And just in the training world, we're seeing just an explosion of leadership programs out there that really address this. And my experience of it is that your growth will be a function of how much you work on yourself and how much you grow yourself. And your limitations or your shortfalls or your obstacles or your shortcomings are equally a function of the work that you're not doing on yourself. There is nowhere to hide because you are the prism through which everything is being shone. And the more you work on yourself and inspire and grow and evolve, the more so your company will do it as an extension of you. Secondly, let's have a look at employees. CEOs, leadership are rolling up their sleeves. Here we have the CEO of Ben & Jerry's and Timberland getting out there and getting their hands dirty with their organization. We see companies bringing their values to life in palpable ways throughout their organization, whether it's Starbucks and their Global Month of Service, Timberland, you've got, you know, here Whole Foods, all the signage inside their HQ and celebrating employees out in their stores, not celebrating their products, celebrating their values and celebrating their employees as an extension of those values. You've got companies reframing how they enlist new talent. Here is Unilever's sort of enrollment brochures where they celebrate everybody in their company as meet our new head of sustainability and our bright future is made by you. The employee. It's a whole different mindset, a servant leader mindset that serves their internal stakeholders, employees, as effectively as it does their external stakeholders. You recognize and inspire employees. REI, it was the darling of the Cannes Advertising Festival last year, won all the awards and so on. It started off as an HR initiative because they wanted to foster internal culture, so they wanted to give everybody a day off. And then it took on a life of its own. In the first year, 100 companies joined. 2016, 400 companies joined, and it became a phenomenon that drove so much earned media and bottom-line value to the company. Why? Because on Black Friday, where Americans take pride in, and I'm an American citizen now, as well as Australian, they take pride in trampling each other, buying stuff that they don't want. In opposition to that, they actually said, listen, let's shut our stores, and everyone go out into the wilderness and go out into the wild, celebrate our core values, and just post a photo of where you are. And they got 1.6 million photographs posted by people within the brand community. And finally, you've got to incentivize and reward your employees. In Tom's case, they do giving trips where certain employees go to the other side of the world and experience giving firsthand and come back and report on it inside the company. You've got the Global Month of Service with Starbucks. And with Starbucks, they have a leadership meeting each year and they bring all the employees together and they ask them to ideate what different impact programs they want to do that year. Co-creating it with their employees. Again, a servant leadership mindset. So the key takeaway here is engage, leverage the humanity of your employees if you want to unlock their advocacy. They are not employees. Facebook just banned the term employee internally because they're not employees. They're called people now. You're only allowed to refer to them as people. Shocking proposition. Starbucks calls all their employees partners. They do not allow the word employee inside their organization. This may sound silly, but language is how we codify behavior. It's how we understand each other. It's how we relate to each other. And shifts in language like that can be absolutely profound in terms of defining the new relatedness that will inspire engagement amongst all your organization, whether it's employees or customers. And then as we look beyond employees, let's have a look at consumers, that elusive consumer, those younger consumers. The tragedy is for all of us as marketers who are trying to build our business is that we're no longer solely in control, right? The consumer out there, you know, we've facilitated a dialogue through social media. They're emboldened. They've, you know, been activists for years now. So really the first choice for a consumer is, do I want to be part of your story? Because someone just posted a video of a cat on Facebook and it's hilarious. And really to inspire that participation, you've got to make them the hero of the story. It's not about making the company, your products, your services, even your impact programs the hero of the story. It's about making them the hero of the story. And then that conversation you have with them, it can't be static. It's got to be dynamic. It's got to be evolving. You can't keep saying the same thing over and over again and expect to maintain engagement. So, how should you approach this? Well, ideally, everyone should, as a function of this servant leader mentality, communicate in an outbound sense. We are of service to our employees, our company is of service to our consumers, and the whole brand community is of service to the world at large. But here's what most companies do. Even when it comes to purpose, they talk about themselves. They talk about their products, their services, they talk about their purpose programs. You open up their foundation page and it says, our foundation was founded in 1967 and since then we've done X, Y, and Z. Instead of saying, too many kids go to bed hungry every night. At blah blah company, we believe this has to stop. That's why, since 1964, we have partnered with Feeding America to get blah blah blah. Do you see the difference? It's about getting off yourself and about stopping communicating in a self-directed way and getting onto those lives who you're affecting. And really, the fundamental shift that needs to occur is sort of oversimplified here, but typically this is what a lot of brands do when it comes to purpose. They kind of map the hierarchical, the org structure model across to their impact model. So they've got their purpose, their values, their story, their products, their services, their programs, and the impact it has in the world. This is what Ben & Jerry's does, which is not only one of the fastest growing brands in the Unilever portfolio, but one of the most lauded organizations in terms of purpose. And this is by their own admission. They turn it upside down and they say, what is our purpose? What are our values? What are the movements or partners that we can align with? And then how do we mobilize our community to that end? It's this upward-facing, outbound mindset which has driven their growth, and that's why, you know, Ben & Jerry's customers are 2.5 times more loyal than other customers out there, and all the data and stats around that. So what does this mean? Who here has a husband, wife, boyfriend, girlfriend, partner, significant other? Raise your hand. Husband, wife, right? Okay, who's got two? Who's got... No, my wife is arriving in a day. So, no, I don't. The point is, the challenge for all of us as brands is we've got to scale intimacy. We've got to relate to countless people on an intimate level in this outbound sense. So how do we do that? Well, here are three kind of broad stroke strategies to achieving that. The first is co-creation. When you co-create, you actually engage your stakeholders because they've got a role to play. So this is in Canada for Duracell. And, you know, their whole campaign was power warmth. So they had bus shelters. And if you put your hands up against the other person, there's a pad on one side, pad on the other. And when you did that, it would complete the circuit and the heaters would go on above. Everyone's like, oh my God, I want to wash my hands, but this is awesome. So co-creation. Secondly, co-authorship. So Dove is, you know, a famous soap brand, which is really probably not that much different to any other soap brand out there, but their Real Beauty campaign has driven so much growth for them. And what they've done now is effectively all their marketing is a social experiment. Most recently, they put these doorways in 6 different countries around the world. One said average, one said beautiful, and they filmed women as they got to choose which one they went through. And most women were kind of like, oh my God, you know, I always knew it to be true, and now here it is. And then there was those other women who were like, oh my God, you know, the one at the party you always invite, you're like, oh my God, I'm so beautiful. But they filmed that and they shared it all around the world, and it was, you know, this is where they unlock the self-esteem issues of women publicly to address this whole notion of real beauty. And so they're a social experiment. Well, Tom's with one day without shoes, you know, keep it really simple. Take your shoes off, take a photo, and a pair of shoes will be given. And thirdly, collaboration. You know, Levi's, a sustainability leader now, had the opportunity to celebrate the 140-year anniversary of their 501s. And you'd think they'd do what they always do, which is they get some handsome guy and some cute girl and they'd kind of slung all over each other with that post-coital look and you'll be like, oh my God, Levi's so cool, right? They didn't do that. They reached out to everyone and said, share your interpretation. And they invited everyone who has a pair of 501s to take a photo of themselves in their 501s and send it in, and some of them were so inappropriate. Everyone suddenly became an installation artist. I have to be nude. But what they then did was they created a book that they distributed in the store. They got real people to do fashion shows all across America, and they actually used those photos at point of sale. They gave co-ownership of the brand over to its community, and that offset so much of the content creation burden for them. It drove so much engagement. It drove so much PR and earned media because everyone was in it together. Does that make sense? It's such a powerful mindset. So the key takeaway here is be the celebrant, not celebrity, of your brand community. Be the celebrant. Celebrate your stakeholders. Go out into the world and empower them to make a difference and then tell those stories. And they will advocate for you all day long. And your brand and your products will assume that badge value that means when they walk down the street, they're like, oh my God, I'm not wearing a pair of shoes. This is who I am. This is a reflection of who I am, my shoes, my jeans, my jacket, and more. And then finally, out into the world. As we telescope out from your personal leadership, out into the employees, your company culture, out into your community of customers, and then out into the world, what should you do? The reality is this. People rise to the conversation you grow around them. If you have a transactional relationship with your customer base, they'll talk to you in terms of dollars and cents and product benefits, and it'll be a race to the bottom. If you talk to them in a relational sense, based on shared values and a common goal, they will rise to that opportunity as well. So Elon Musk does not have an ad agency. But what he does when you go into a Tesla showroom is they empower everyone who goes in there to know so much about the car and its mission that they can go and talk about it meaningfully at dinner parties and tell you things, and they basically become salespeople for the brand. And that's why he did a partnership with BMW and Nissan, and that's why he opened up his IP to competitors, and that's why, you know, he had the Infinity Mile warranty, because it was all in service of his larger mission of enabling sustainable transportation. In the B2B world, Intel, a couple of years ago at CES, he got up there and said, by 2016, we'll have the first conflict-free minerals, you know, supply chain. And everyone else in the industry needs to do the same. Or CVS, the largest pharmaceutical chain in the US, about 18 months ago, they said, we're going to ban tobacco products. Depending on whose estimate you read, that could cost them up to $1.5 billion. Could you imagine the guy who walks into the border and says, let's just ban that? It was not a nice conversation, I'm sure. But when you watch the video from the CEO, what he said was, we are the first national pharmaceutical chain to ban tobacco products because we want to lead the future of healthcare. And what did they rename themselves 3 weeks later? CVS Health. And what is their tagline? Health is everything. And what do they want to own in relationship to health? Everything. They are positioning themselves for the future. That said, purpose washing is deadly. You've probably seen over here, you know, Volkswagen, the diesel emission scandal, upwards of $18 billion, that cost them criminal charges against all the leadership, and more recently, the Wells Fargo scandal, where 5,000 employees were opening up false accounts to hit their numbers so that they could keep their jobs and get the bonuses they want. So you can never be disingenuous about it. But really, the bottom line here is that brands need to lead conversations that positively shape consumer behavior and thinking. That will polarize some people. Yet at the same time, it'll drive deep loyalty from those who believe in the same things. And just a great example of this is Starbucks. Their global platform is Shared Planet. And over the course of the last 8 years, they've talked about gridlock in Congress, same-sex marriage, post-traumatic stress disorder, online education for veterans, racism. But really what they've done is they have led a constant conversation directed towards our experience on a shared planet and then walked through these issues one after another. And it has kept them top of mind, it has made them culturally relevant, it has inspired advocacy amongst their stakeholder community, and it has driven billions of dollars worth of earned media over the course of the last 8 years. So much so that Howard Schultz is on the cover of Time magazine with the headline, What Starbucks Knows About America, and it says jobs, education, veterans, and so on. When did the CEO of a coffee company end up in that position? Because they are shaping culture. So the mission for each one of you in this room to compete and win, in the best sense, the purpose wars, is to transcend your products, your services, your category, to shape culture. And the way you do that is that you need to be a mission with a company, not a company with a mission. Subtle shift, but fundamental and transformative. If you allow your mission, your purpose, to inform everything you do, it will give you a level of integrity, credibility, and authenticity, internally and externally, that will turn your customers, your employees, into rabid advocates. And so, as I said, these slides are going to be on the app, and you've got the worksheets in front of you. We're doing that because so you can take these back to your team and work through those questions with them so that you get as much value as possible out of this. But I want to leave you with one thought. Does anyone know what this is? Neil Armstrong, right? Neil Armstrong, first footprint on the moon. Anyone else? What else is it? It's the biggest marketing mistake in the history of mankind. Does anyone know why? It's a hoax. They forgot to put their logo on the bottom of the boot. It was made by 3M. Their positioning was innovation. They had the whole planet literally looking at one point in time. And there's some guy back in Minneapolis going, do you think we should have put a logo on the bottom of that boot? And that's not my story. This is part of the tour that you get when you go to their innovation center. The point is this. Every single one of you have a unique purpose, a unique role to play that is informed by your heritage, your leadership, and your vision for the future. And we need it now more than ever. Do not miss the opportunity to articulate that and unlock the true power of those supercomputers in your pocket and the hearts and minds of your entire stakeholder community to work with you to build your business and at the same time build a better world. Thank you very much.
Hey, so can we just talk just for a little bit? We just want to dig into a few of those areas, right? Brands.
Yeah.
So is brand and purpose the same thing?
Purpose is why you exist. That then, what exists? A company. There used to be a distinction, a more meaningful distinction between what a brand was and a company was, because you'd manage your image as a brand. It'd be this perception you'd like to sell to other people. In our experience, what's happening is the difference between a brand and a company is dissolving. Because two things are happening. One, this radical transparency is being imposed on companies. So when the BP oil spill happened in the Gulf of Mexico, they didn't want to know who owned the oil rig. They wanted to know the name of the boat that the CEO of BP was on in the British Isles when all of this was happening. They look behind the company to the parent company to what they're doing. In which case, companies and their brand, what they're saying about themselves and what they're doing has to be much more closely aligned. And at the same time, the marketplace is becoming both more rewarding and more punitive. So if you do it well and you do it with authenticity and you even volunteer your shortcomings, people will celebrate that and they'll work with you. If you're disingenuous or outright dishonest, you'll be punished and pillared and stoned out in public, you know, as an organization. So all of that is to say that that distinction between a brand and a company is less meaningful now because they need to be so much more aligned.
So 20 years ago, the talk was like, you had a vision statement, you had a mission statement, and then you had a something else, and then maybe, you know, some product brand stuff.
Yep.
So do you throw all that out, or is it the same thing, or are you just using different words for the same stuff?
No, it's interesting,
how does it all fit,
isn't it? And,
fit
you know,
together?
You've all got vendors, right, and they all use different language. You're like, I don't even know what they're talking about, right? So, no, it's not about throwing any of that out, and I'll be just to be specific about what each one is. The purpose is why you exist. Why you exist as a company. Your mission is what you do to achieve that. Your values are what you stand for in that process, and your vision is where you're headed. So think of it as a sort of like a through line between why we exist, what we're doing to make it happen, what we stand for on the way, and your vision is where you're headed towards. And in truth, you're right, there wasn't that much talk about purpose 5 years ago, so you kind of go, well, is it really that important? But I think as many of us in this room would privately confirm, in the absence of that now, not only are you not relevant to the marketplace, but a lot of people got away with just sort of paying lip service to what their mission was. It'd be in your annual report, it might be on the wall, you used to talk about it when you're onboarding new employees, but other than that, nothing happened. But because of the demographic shifts, because of the expectations of these new millennials who really don't want to work in big companies, who really are much more predisposed to work with companies that share the same values, you've got to articulate that. So purpose is actually adding something on to all those other things. Yeah.
And is this like a domino thing? If you play with values, then you have to look at purpose, or if you tweak purpose, then there's a trickle-down effect? Or can you work with them individually in terms of your experience of working with all these different companies?
They are connected. They are connected. And at the starting point, the most logical starting point is purpose because it informs all the others. And in truth, when you start to do this work with a company that up to that point hadn't had purpose, it's not about throwing everything out the door. And it's interesting, everything a company does from its mission, vision, values to all its communications, internal and external, are typically a symptom of something that is yet to be articulated. So it lives in the company, but it hasn't been named.
So you said, and if you work with a company that doesn't have a purpose, so what about if you don't have a Blake to point to? What about if the company genuinely doesn't have a purpose, or the purpose is to sell more stuff?
It's interesting. Oddly enough, very few entrepreneurs, maybe some in Silicon Valley, go into business just to sell, right? Let's just get out of the gate fast and sell and go and buy an island. But more often than not, most entrepreneurs, there was some instinct that motivated them to enjoy the entrepreneurial roller coaster, right? So in my belief is that every company has a purpose. No one woke up in the morning and just said, I just want to fleece everybody, you know, and then get out. And so I think everybody does have a purpose, and the reason they don't go there or they don't articulate it or they haven't brought that to life for everyone else in their organization is it's really hard for them to see because it's right in front of them. It's everything who they are and everything's a manifestation of that. So it's about looking at all those symptoms and working backwards. And then once you've identified that purpose, it's not about throwing it all out, as I said, it's about tweaking it all and going, oh my God, 3 degrees that way, 4 degrees that way, and bring it all into alignment. It all kind of clicks into place.
Is it like a business plan that you tweak every year? Is it like a strategic plan that you review every 3 years? Well, is it set in stone?
There's certain realities that we deal with, like, what is it, the average life cycle of a CMO is 18 months and 3 days? So that comes along and goes, right, here we go, we're going to put our imprimatur on this. Look, I'm here, you're all fired. That aside, you look at it and go, actually, what is our long-term goal? For example, Paul Polman suspended quarterly reporting. Why? Because he couldn't discharge a long-term strategy at the same time he was beholden to the street every 3 months with analyst calls. And that was a big thing at the time, but it enabled him to do what he's going to do. So it's a long-term play, and it should be informed with not just your business goals, but the difference you want to make in the world that will in turn drive your business growth.
You said the data says that people stay longer in a purpose-driven organization.
Right.
And also, when we first talked, you talked to me about the importance of internal communication and purpose, as well as external. Can you just join the dots?
Yeah, I mean, it's really interesting. We did a survey, and 100% of people inside your organizations are qualified to be human. Astonishing proposition. And a couple of things are happening. I'll give you two examples, because I don't want to sound like theory. PwC, one of the big four, three of the big four now have purpose practice areas, which tells you there's something going on. PwC, by their own admission, when they onboard new talent, because typically millennials don't want to work for a big company, they will do a one-hour interview about the personal purpose of that individual, which creates a very different experience for the prospective employee to go inside a company and go, oh my God, look what they care about and how they align with my values, and that allows them to win the talent wars and also align around purpose. Another example is, you know, one of the companies people point to is Patagonia, and they're famous for their childcare and the different facilities they have on their property to really nurture their employees. And the folks at Patagonia put out an article last week in the States, which was all about they're shifting their focus from not only nurturing the culture and the individual employees, but to the families of employees. To the families. Because when you nurture the family, you nurture the employee, but then by extension, the company becomes part of the family. And that influences, you know, like retention rates, return rates, with maternity leave, and all these other bottom line drivers. So your purpose communications internally have to manifest themselves as clearly as your external communications, and then it builds the bottom line in the same way.
And finally, you talked about, in a busy world, the importance of making it tight. Mm-hmm. How do you find the balance between the richness of layered messaging mm-hmm. and true storytelling?
Yeah.
More like a great movie mm-hmm. versus making something so digestible that you can hit it.
You know, the reality is that from a business point of view, we're in a competitive landscape, but also from a communications point of view. And we live at a time where your entire stakeholder community can build your business with you. So like it or not, we've got to get very succinct and clear about what we're saying. And in our experience, the truth is there is something at the heart of your brand, that it can be distilled down to something very simple. And what's going on right now is a gold rush. What we're seeing in the States is what are companies trying to own? That used to be profit and purpose down here with the foundation, sustainability, corporate citizenship. Now it's like this, in which case there's a gold rush going on. So what does Unilever own in the CPG world? They own sustainability. What does Starbucks own in the coffee category? They own shared. What does Chipotle kind of own in the food category? Integrity. You know, what does Airbnb? Here's Airbnb's insight. They do not sell apartments or homes that you can take a holiday in around the world. That's not what Airbnb does. They realize that the difference between being in a home and being in a hotel is that you belong in a home. So what are they selling? They're selling a sense of belonging, which is why their positioning is belong anywhere, which speaks to their product, but also when you think of it from a higher order messaging point of view, during the Grammys and everything, you saw their commercial We Accept, and their overarching proposition is universal belonging. So they're in the business of selling belonging. So every single one of us, it doesn't matter what your company is like, there is a way to distill down into two or three words the heart of your brand.
You said something interesting last night. You said when a company hasn't done the work to define it, mm-hmm. they come across as multiple personalities.
Yeah. All we do with all our marketing dollars is broadcast our schizophrenia at everyone. I mean, think about it. We're this on Facebook, we're this on Snapchat, we're this on this, and the consumers out there is going, I don't know who they are, and they're freaking crazy. And they're ill-equipped to talk about you to anybody else. And those brands, the reason all those big brands are kind of getting so succinct is because they want to equip everyone within their organization to talk on their behalf. So most companies spend all their time broadcasting their schizophrenia, and one of the problems that we come across all the time, in the words of clients or prospective clients, is help us connect the dots. We've either got a global footprint, or we're so siloed, or we've got an org structure, or we've been doing disparate things organically for the last 10 years, and now we've got all this different messaging all over here. How do we bring it all together? And invariably, that begs the question of what your purpose is, so you can create alignment. And it's not about changing those things, but really aligning them around a singular message.
Big thanks, Simon.
Okay. Thank you. Cool.